And I, you know, would describe a lot of people on the right as being socialists. I would consider Steve Bannon to be a socialist. I would consider the 2016 iteration of Donald Trump, the candidate, to be a socialist based on what he was saying. I consider Tucker Carlson to be a socialist. You know, now if you have Governor Cuomo, who wants to give tens of millions of dollars to Amazon to bring an office to New York, you have AOC, an actual self-identified socialist, standing up and saying, this is outrageous. And then you have Tucker Carlson going on his Fox News program and saying, I agree with her completely, because I think people are realizing that neoliberalism doesn't work. And I think the real right-left difference, to the extent that those terms even have any currency or coherence, mm-hmm. I think you see in France.
I love this take. Because as conservatives often do, Glenn Greenwald is operating like a conservative here and literally defeating the purpose, like destroying the argument that he is concocting in the first 30 seconds with the last 30 seconds of the same argument, like the same sentence, by straight up saying, these words don't mean anything. Yeah, okay, man. You're right. They literally don't mean anything if you think that, you know, Trump is a socialist or Tucker Carlson is a socialist, because every now and then he presents himself as a person who is against, like, big companies. I can't believe this. Listen, you don't have to be like a gigantic theory nerd to comprehend that Tucker Carlson is a gigantic grifter and has always been a libertarian and a right-wing libertarian, not like a left libertarian, okay? Wild to me to assume that the warmongering Tucker Carlson, who now takes like a lighter stance on war now, somewhat isolationist, who still aggravates against minorities and whatnot, is considered a socialist because they want the American Volk, which would be like the WASPs, I guess, to maintain their grip of power and have a larger piece of the pie overall. While the main argument that Tucker Carlson is launching every night is literally doing racial agitprop against minorities. Tucker Carlson is a fake populist. He adopts left-wing economic populism sometimes specifically to drive home his real agenda of WASP nationalism. And I know another person who used to do that. I've been saying this for years, but people don't listen to me. And I know that this is a big cliche, but it's Hitler. That's what Hitler did as well. And it's not like Hitler is known for his socialism. The person who sided with the corporations and was backed by the corporations and corporate funders and, privatized gigantic swaths of the German economy at the time in comparison to where it was, is not a fucking socialist because he still put forward the Autobahn contracts. Hitler wasn't known for his social democratic policies. He was known for his nationalism. Considering Tucker Carlson to be a socialist is really in line with what idiotic Dinesh D'Souza-style Republicans say about how Nazis were actually socialists because that's in the name, despite the fact that they literally killed socialists, and they are not nationalists, even though that's also in the name, and there's no reason for why they're not actually nationalists. But they weren't. And a person that is saying this sort of stuff is so psychotic. I don't know what else to say here. What has happened because of neoliberals in positions of power in the global political arena adopting the aesthetics of progress by latching on to straight identity politics has created so many reactionary points of view within those who otherwise truly at some point had the best interests of the working class. There are so many people who just like despise identity politics or what they perceive to be identity politics because of the way that intersectional feminism and intersectionality in general has purposely avoided the conversation around class in mainstream media, and people have just lost their fucking minds. Instead of steering that ship in the right direction, they have decided to completely abandon it in its entirety and assume that a big part of being working class implies that you have to literally fucking shit on marginalized people. It's ridiculous, especially because it avoids the reality that so many of these marginalized communities are literally a part of the working class. But the reality that a lot of people on the left don't want to recognize is that kind of reactionary politics is actually very popular. It's very easy to say, these guys are fucking ridiculous. Because, I'm sorry, picturing a better world, picturing a more egalitarian society is kind of foolish at times. And when you are running on the belief that, like, if you set the rules in the way that you want to see the world, when you have no fucking power whatsoever, when those in positions of power are simply aesthetically adopting the rules that you live by, and you operate on that worldview and navigate the world like everyone is fucking committing a thought crime or whatever the fuck Republicans consider it whenever they are toxic or whenever they actually engage in some sort of microaggression, then, you know, you're going to lose a lot of allies, which is why I always say you have to sell your point of view. And the way you sell your point of view, the way you sell trans rights to everyone, is by first hammering on the class point of view that impacts all or the largest group of individuals. You tell people Medicare for all means all people, okay? That includes fucking Nazis even, all right? Which is why I always say this. And then when they say, well, I don't want trans people to have healthcare, I'm like, really? You're gonna say no to fucking healthcare because trans people are gonna get it? You're a psychopath. Shut the fuck up. No, you're gonna suck it the fuck up and you're gonna take this free motherfucking healthcare, bitch.
I think you see in France too, like Marine Le Pen, you know, the fascist far right candidate, when she ran both times, she ran to the left of Macron for sure. But even the French socialists, in terms of wanting to give workers better benefits and better pensions.
So here's the thing I do not understand, right? When Glenn is skeptical of the Democratic Party, understandably, whenever the Democratic Party says things like, we care about the workers, we care about the working class, we care about workers' rights, he's understandably skeptical of them and says, oh, fuck these guys, they're lying to you. All they care about is, like, you know, corporate overreach, their corporate overloads, overlords that, you know, line their pockets. So why is he just as skeptical of reactionaries all around the world? That's the thing I do not understand, because Tucker Carlson has never shown any interest, not even as much as the fake ass fucking Democratic Party, with regards to, like, increasing the minimum wage or marginally bettering the lives of the American working class. I've never seen Tucker Carlson take a staunch position on taxing the wealthy, for example. He very rarely talks about it because that's actually something that would put him at odds with those who line his fucking pockets. Why is Glenn Greenwald not as skeptical of Tucker Carlson and will adopt the terminology that Tucker Carlson wants to put out as though he is, like, genuinely interested in bettering the material conditions of the white working class, at least in America, which I don't even think Tucker Carlson wants? Why the fuck is he not as skeptical of Tucker Carlson and Marie Le Pen as he is of the Democratic Party? This makes no sense to me whatsoever. It makes no sense. Let's see what he has to say. Did you read any of the articles I wrote on this topic or listen to the full context of the interview where this was discussed? Or are you proudly responding to the 6-word snippet the Daily Caller social media manager fed you to get you to do what you're doing? Look how easy social media managers play these people. They feed them a 6-word snippet. They get excited and think, oh, good, I can mock this without having to do any work and get people on my side. Then they're off to the races. Okay, but I want to understand what his position is. Like, I don't want to see the fucking 6-word snippet. Does he talk about his actual fucking position or not? I feel like the bigger point he's making is about populism versus neoliberalism and how voters from both sides of the spectrum are realizing that neoliberal order is failing them. I don't think Glenn is someone to shit on marginalized people. I feel like his views are really shaped by his South American coverage, where it's really populism versus neoliberalism. Like, Bolivia is a great example of that. Yeah, except the difference is he also very clearly has demonstrated time and time again that he does not give a fuck about trans people. I'm sorry. Like, I think he literally feels as though trans rights is basically a byproduct of, like, neoliberal identity politics, and that trans people should be an afterthought, and any trans person that talks about fucking trans people is, you know, just doing bullshit. The point that he gets frustrated at is literally when homophobia is demonstrated by those he is, like, somewhat aligned with, and in that point he does marginal pushback. Do you see what I'm saying? He will do marginal pushback whenever homophobia is expressed within his, like, newfound audience, because he's fucking gay. So obviously he's going to push back on homophobia. Like, he's an advocate for gay rights. He's a gay man himself. But when it comes to, like, other things that some on the anti-identity politics left has declared to be, like, ridiculous, like sex work for trans rights and shit like that, he is very quick to belittle that level of activism. I engage in some pushback when I feel as though, from a position of profound privilege that I have still, when trans people are or trans activists are advocating for things that I consider is going to be unfathomable to the majority, to a degree that like it is overboard or whatever. I don't know how to describe it. How else to describe it? Like when someone says womix in or someone is like engaging in that sort of thing, like just like throwing X's every now and then in different places. Like that shit is aesthetic. It's bullshit. There are plenty of intersectional theory folk who focus on class actually. No. I know that the original works, including the person who coined the term intersectionality, is literally a fucking Bernard brother, a Bernard sister. And yes, I know that a lot of queer theory utilizes Marxist theory, anarchist theory, blah, blah, blah. Intersectionality has to feature class. Intersectionality has to be placed atop of a dialectical materialist framework. I don't have a problem with that. That's how I see it. That's how I look at it. But what I was trying to simply state is that intersectionality and the way that it's demonstrated through popular culture and through mainstream politics is demonstrated in the most liberal capitalist way possible. Do you get what I'm saying? That's the problem. So people will immediately attribute intersectionality or any sort of like a cause that features identity as a negative way because they are reminded of the Tumblr style social justice warrior movements. In a certain sense, it is a distraction. Zizek, while in full support of trans people, explained that the foregrounding the issue of trans rights as the democratic establishment is not a winning strategy when they're trying to win the hearts and minds of normal people. This is a tactic of obfuscation of class and material politics. Yes, Hassan, I agree with you. I mean, I've said this as well. But it also doesn't mean that trans rights take a back seat. You know what I mean? You got to mix the trans rights pill in with other pills and shove it down people's throats. Lol. Hey, that's my advocacy for it. That's the way I do it. Like I engage in pushback when I see transphobia happening. I describe to people what my worldview is and what I think is best to do. I think you invoke dialectical materialism. People don't know what that phrase means, me included. Your intersectionality should be grounded within a framework where the world is designed around commodity production, how goods are produced, and how labor and the relationship between those who work under a boss and the fucking bosses themselves. That is what the world is designed around, and people should move from that starting point and build blocks on top of that. Yeah, those who give the work and those who take the work, or those who are hiring versus those who are working in those positions. The employer versus the employee. I'm trying to simplify it in terms, okay?
The vision is, you know, you have this kind of right-wing populism, which really is socialism, that says we should close our borders, not allow unconstrained immigration.
Yeah, that's just what Tucker Carlson wants. He just wants to close our borders and you know, not allow unconstrained. All right, someone send me the fucking long clip of this. I want to see the whole thing. I need to see the whole thing because it's so stupid. Yeah, socialism is when closed borders and doing immigration control. How long will it take for Hassan to finally lose respect? I mean, I have already. I've lost all of the chunks of respect that I had for Glenn Greenwald. It's just that ultimately, one day, I know that he is going to fucking still do some decent work down the line, and you all are gonna, I don't want you all to fucking be like, oh, well, he's a dumbass otherwise, so I'm not gonna take his work seriously. His coverage in Brazil is profoundly important against the Bolsonaro administration. His coverage in regards to, like, you know, NSA spying on both Americans and also foreign citizens, that is profoundly important. Okay, Boomer Girl has done more for leftists than Glenn, dude. Yeah, you guys are being unhinged if you think that. I'm sorry. You know, that's a great question. Oh my God. If Tucker Carlson and Donald Trump are socialists, then why the fuck is Bolsonaro not a socialist? After all, he certainly provided a major hurdle for economic relief to be given to the Brazilian people, but ultimately he gave a lot of money to the Brazilian people. He allowed a lot of money to be given to the Brazilian people. That's socialism, right? I'm a leftist, okay? A lot of people say I'm a grifter or whatever. Or not a lot of people, but some people say I'm a grifter and I'm not a fucking real leftist or whatever. But what do I talk about? As an anti-capitalist, what the fuck have I been hammering as the most significant thing that is profoundly important for leftist causes, or even if it's marginally bettering the material conditions of the working class? What have I been talking about? Bessemer unionization efforts in Alabama and $15 minimum wage. These are the two most fucking significant like electoralist causes that we could talk about right now. Tucker Carlson, at a time when we should be talking about this, at a time when like leftists should be talking about this nonstop and screaming from the fucking rooftops, he's constantly talking about Dr. Seuss being banned by liberals or whatever the fuck. Why isn't he talking about unionization efforts? Why isn't he talking about how profoundly important unions are? Why isn't he talking about $15 minimum wage and the Republican and Democratic gridlock in Congress? Why is he constantly doing right-wing identity politics? Because he's not legit. He doesn't give a shit.
And not allow this kind of transnational global corporatist elite to take everything for themselves under the guise of neoliberalism. We should distribute that more to workers, which is basically what Bernie Sanders was saying.
Right.
You know, 10 years ago, the left in America, in the United States, was always anti-immigration. When I started writing about politics, open borders was considered to be a Koch brothers, Chamber of Commerce plot that George W. Bush and Dick Cheney were pushing because it would help American businesses by increasing the flow of labor and driving down wages. And the left...
unrestricted flow of migrant labor into the country won't drive down wages if we have strong labor protections, okay? If we have strong regulatory protections for the working class. It is the lack of labor protections that create a two-tiered labor pool where there is a permanent underclass within the migrant community that American bosses and American business owners can constantly fucking use as a cudgel against the documented working class. Economies have the capacity to scale. Okay, there is no lump of labor and immigrants are rushing to the bottom and stealing out all the fucking jobs. That's why you have unions. Okay, the real solution here is documenting immigrants rather than allowing them to stay undocumented or forcing them to stay undocumented and constantly pushing the fear that they will get fucking deported if they even act out or if they even want more wages, putting them in a position where they cannot demand all of the stolen wages from them. They cannot speak out against sexual harassment in the workplace because they have no protection from the government. They have no representation whatsoever because they are the permanent underclass. And when you have a gigantic labor pool of people who cannot speak out and are basically destined to a lifetime of wage slavery and horrific conditions in these factories, then why are you as a business owner ever going to fucking improve the material conditions of the American working class? You can just tell the rest of the documented labor pool to fuck right off because there's always going to be a sea of talent coming in and replacing the other immigrants that you just fired and deported. Shutting down our borders is impossible to begin with, especially when we have oppressed the Latin American allies and neighboring states so tremendously and destroyed their way of life so tremendously that there is always going to be instability there unless we change our ways. There are always going to be people that want to come to the United States. The only way to stop immigration successfully is by helping these countries rather than continuously keeping them down and shutting off our borders, unless you are willing to kill all of the immigrants that come through the southern border. Like, that's just the reality. And it is slowly but surely reaching that level. There's only two ways to solve conflicts. You either increase the pressure and implement deterrence measures in the same way that Donald Trump did, and there was a brutal honesty to what he was doing there, or you have to figure out the root cause of the problem and de-escalate. And we are not moving towards the escalation. We are moving further and further towards escalating violence and the cruelty that we subject them to.
And when you started talking about politics in the 90s, it was pretty clear liberal versus conservative, what that meant. Those terms seem to be completely antiquated and outdated to describe today, right? On one side, as you said, I don't know if I'd call them socialists, but you certainly have populist nationalists. We can put the Bannon, Tucker on kind of that side.
Why is the Daily Caller editor Omid Malik actually pushing for a smarter clarification on Glenn Greenwald's insane take? I mean, he is more correct. He's basically saying like they're national populists, as in like they're Nazis. He's literally saying the truth. Like, he's trying so desperately not to say they're nationalist socialists. Okay, that's what he's trying to say by... He's just flipping it and saying, they're just nationalist populists.
Verse, and it doesn't fit neatly with Sanders. We can put him aside for a second. But very clearly on the other side of that, you have corporatists and globalists. And maybe that's exactly what you're saying kind of synonymously for neoliberal.
I just don't agree with that. I do agree that like populists, both on the left and right, position themselves against corporatists and those who are like technocratic neoliberals. But throwing the fucking term around like globalist and nationalist in this way is just, I don't know, you're playing a little fast and loose with the definitions here, okay? Like the globalist corporatists, what, you think fucking CEOs, I mean, you think CEOs like care about humanity in the way that they are, in the way that globalism is supposed to care about humanity? Do you think nationalists care about their fucking nation, or do you think they care about what they believe their nation should look like and the ethnic homogeny of their nation? It's dumb as fuck to apply these sorts of terms. There is no like a populist movement, and there should not be a populist movement that is aligned with actual fascists who consider themselves to be like WASP nationalists or whatever the fuck Tucker Carlson is, as though we have like unified goals. We do not have unified goals unless you literally think, unless you straight up think that like Tucker Carlson genuinely would not have a problem with giving trans people healthcare and documenting the 12 million immigrants that currently live inside of our borders and does not want to purge them and cleanse the population of that brown rot that he considers to be brown rot, basically. A person who literally says things like immigrants are dirty and straight up channels Nazi rhetoric like that is not an ally. Like, you cannot consider them to be an ally. You just don't see some workers as workers.
They were very vocal against the environment we saw, one that mirrors a lot of what we see now in the stifling of dissent. And so a lot of the creativity, the innovation of thought was coming from the left during that period of time against the repression and the surveillance state that was being implemented from the right. It seems to be exactly the opposite now, but certainly you're getting an audience and having much more thoughtful conversations with what's been thought of historically right wing today. And you're not getting any of that from the globalist corporatist wing, who are now embodied, or excuse me, personified by Colbert and Olbermann. So the question to you is, did you and I change, or did they?
Wait, so see, this is what I don't understand, though. These motherfuckers literally will say things like, you know, Stephen Colbert is so anti-war, and that's based at a time when like everyone was fucking pro-war. It's like, where were you? You know what Tucker Carlson was doing while Stephen Colbert was fucking anti-war? He was calling Iraqis primitive apes that deserve to be dominated by the American military machine. If Stephen Colbert became more of a fucking liberal and no longer holds these, these brave fucking anti-imperialist takes and is like too focused on all the dumb shit, then so are you. Okay. You have changed as well, I guess, if your change is genuine, because I don't really hear about, too much serious consideration to scaling back the American military actions all around the world from those like Tucker Carlson and everyone else. I mean, he does actually take a stance against like American imperialism from time to time, but I don't know. I don't know how fucking legitimate that is. So if Stephen Colbert's opinion changed, then so did yours and so did the likes of you, especially because a lot of conservatives are still very much pro-war. Also, I've never heard you talk about populism. I think left-wing economic populism is good. It's very successful. It's very good at motivating people. It's very good at describing the terms and conditions that American people and workers all around the world experience every day. I think I have no problem with left-wing economic populism. My problem is when people fake adopt left-wing economic populist positions while simultaneously being right-wing populists, which means they are advocating for nationalist policies. But this positioning of like populism versus like corporatism, I find nationalist populism versus corporatist globalism is silly. I don't like that categorization, because I myself am an internationalist, I guess, or a globalist, if you want to use those terms. So I don't give a fuck. And I am deeply anti-corporation. And I believe that all members of all fucking nations, all human beings deserve a base level of material equality. That's what I believe in. And I think that I am a populist in that respect, but I am not a fucking nationalist.
And people on the right are increasingly uncomfortable with monopolistic power and concentrated wealth and of the ability to control our discourse. So I think there's a whole set of issues that we weren't talking about even a decade ago that kind of defy these traditional categories. And that's one of the things that's causing a scramble.
Guys, Hitler was actually a communist, I've decided, because you know how like a lot of these Republicans are actually super based and super red-pilled and super like anti-corporate because they say, I don't know, Google is trying to force feminize your children or some shit. Well, Hitler was actually a communist because, you know, he took businesses away from business owners that happened to be Jewish and minority populations. That's expropriation. So that's communist. He was a fucking communist, I guess. This argument is literally the fucking same argument that dumbass Republicans engage in. Like, it is exactly the same argument that dumbass Republicans engage in when they say shit like Hitler was Hitler was pro-abortion or Hitler was pro-gun control. And that's exactly why they were, just like the Democrats. Without looking at like what he was doing. Hitler was pro-abortion and euthanasia for anyone who was not a part of the dominant purebred Volk, okay? He was very, very anti-abortion, punishable by fucking death, if I'm not mistaken, for the true Germans. Just like he wasn't anti-gun control, or he wasn't pro-gun control when it came to, again, the Folk. I think he's literally just focusing on aesthetics. If you just look at what the GOP says, then maybe you think this, but goddamn, Glenn, look at the other actions they've taken. Okay, so here's what I'll say. You know how I constantly fucking harp on like anti-SJW dudes who are like more hyper-focused on identity politics than the SJWs? This is the same energy from those who are, again, positioning themselves as like anti-IDPOL people that are more hyper-focused on the aesthetics than the neoliberals that they have positioned themselves against by claiming that neoliberals like only care about the aesthetics, which is true, but only focusing on the fucking aesthetics of everything. Like the very same idiots that love cultural signals and cultural signifiers are those who say shit like graduate students are a part of the cultural neoliberal elite and not technically working class and instead PMCs, okay? That's the mentality. Like, as though fucking grad students are not working for like $7 an hour and sucking dick on the side so they can fucking survive. Like, Jesus Christ, dude. Not that there's anything wrong with that. PMC is not like private military. PMC is professional managerial class. I welcome all these people who are understandably critical and cynical about Democratic Party statements and sentiments and the values that neoliberals supposedly care about. I welcome all of those people to be skeptical of the Republicans as well, because the Republicans are lying even harder than the Democrats, okay? For the most part. Oh, here, Dr. Seuss. I gotta do a quick shout out to Dr. Seuss, by the way. There were 85 mentions of Seuss on Fox News today as of 4 p.m. via closed caption. They've covered his purported cancellation every hour since 4 a.m., saying his name an average 7 times an hour. I've got 139 mentions of Seuss on Fox News between 4 a.m. yesterday and midnight. The author purported cancellation was mentioned on all but 3 hours of network's programming. It's Tucker Carlson claiming that the people in charge are canceling Seuss to eliminate a very specific kind of mid-century American culture, a culture that championed meritocracy and colorblindness and the superiority of individual achievement.
For 60 years, American children have read the Sneetches and books like...
Just a reminder that this was not the fucking book that was canceled and that there was no cancellation. It was a self-cancellation from the Seuss Foundation that pulled some of the books that had really gross depictions of Asian people and black people in them. And that the reason why they have to lie about it is because if they were to talk about the truth, as always, they would come across as silly or even worse, racist. Being stunlocked by a fucking children's book like this in the midst of like genuinely serious political conversations happening that could significantly improve the material conditions of the American working class proves that you are not really a fucking leftist or a socialist, but instead just a straight up fucking grifter. I talked about the Dr. Seuss stuff too. I laughed about it and we moved on.
The story is a plea for colorblindness, and that's why the forces of wokeness hate it and Dr. Seuss. When the people in charge cancel Dr. Seuss, what they're really trying to eliminate is a very specific kind of mid-century American culture, a culture that championed meritocracy and colorblindness, and the superiority of individual achievement over tribal identity. These were once called liberal values. Modern liberals don't want to be reminded that they once believed any of this. If your kids are allowed to read Dr. Seuss, they will know this was a different country not so long ago.
I just don't understand. Like, I don't know how you can get to this point. Like, I guess if you're on this level of fucking Kool-Aid, you can just believe anything, I guess. If you have enough energy and initiative to want to believe this bullshit, you will believe it. I don't know. I don't know what to say about this. Honestly, I fucking don't know. Because it's so ridiculous that, like, the coverage of this is completely psychopathic. Like, it's just nuts. But so many conservatives believe it because they keep saying it over and over again.
A place where people tried hard not to hate each other. A place where the population was encouraged, begged by its leaders to reject identity politics in favor of universal values and the things that connect us all.
Yeah, mid-century America was very fucking colorblind, except for when they were enforcing segregation. You know, I don't understand. Why do liberals nowadays want to attack separate but equal? I mean, some level of separation is good. You don't want to be around random strangers when you are having a family outing. So why can't we think about America as a big family? I mean, equality, after all, is in the name, but liberals hate equality. They want to make sure that black people have a worse time overall in a non-separate society. That's Tucker Carlson defending segregation there through and through.